Good morning, everybody.
Good morning, Brent. How are things?
That's fantastic. We've got Joe Cook with us today. Hi, Joe.
Hey, everyone.
Look at that. You guys all have your branded mugs. You got the light bulb mug, Joe. Chris has got his. I'm just sporting the ASU travel mug this morning. Mine's in the mail, right?
It is.
You should give one to all of your guests.
I'm not sure, Brent. Obviously, we're going to have to figure out where exactly in the mail system yours is, because I'm confident that it's supposed to be. I would have expected it there by now. At this point in time,
U.S. Postal Service is not so, motivated to get the mail through in a timely manner.
Well, it's tough, and it's.
We're also on a train route, which is interesting. We just discovered we were losing a lot of mail and discovered that our house is in the neighborhood that they consider the route for training newbies. And so we get newbie mail people all the time and we lose stuff.
Wow.
Not good.
It's also crossing a border, so that sometimes complicates things. So
stuck in customs.
Yep. Perhaps it is.
I'm trying to find a transition moment.
Yeah, no kidding. Got to make a clean break on that. I was trying to think, is there anything about digital body language? No, that doesn't tie into coffee cups in the mail system. I don't know. No, it's a tough one. Joe, welcome back. As always, it's a pleasure to have you with us.
Well, thank you so much. It's really good to be back and chatting with you at the beginning of a new year.
Yeah, still that time frame where we can say it's a new year.
Just, and at some point,
there almost needs to be like a national or international no more New Year Day. Like the heck with Donut Day and the heck with French Fry Day. This is a clearly practical thing. Stop saying Happy New Year.
I'm going 1st of February on that, I think.
Yeah, that's a safe one, depending on who you're emailing. So, yeah. Excellent. Joe, just for those who didn't join us the last time, maybe are unfamiliar with you, give yourself a quick introduction and then we'll jump into talking about reading digital body language.
Sure. So I am a virtual classroom and webinar specialist. So my company, Lightbulb Moment, we train teams of people in just how to design and deliver live online sessions. And you guys do a great example of that, of what you're doing here. I've had a background in learning and development for 25 years. Jesus, going up in octaves. And before that, I did journalism. I was self-employed. I worked for all sorts of different companies and sectors that I won't bore you with. But right now, it's all about the virtual classroom and webinars.
Excellent. And we talked about that, some tips and stuff the last time you were on joined us earlier in the fall, some general things around that. But we got a little bit more of a specific topic here today, reading digital body language. It's something that I think you've been focusing on a little bit and trying to help people understand, etc. So maybe, where do we start? What do you describe as, digital body language?
Well, I was thinking about the way that we deliver virtual classrooms, and one of the challenges that people often have, and they really need to get over before they can embrace virtual classrooms and webinars to an extent as well, is that we can't see our audience. There are 26 people with us today and I can't see them. So how can I build a relationship with people? How can I know what they're learning or what they're thinking or what they're doing? And that's the challenge we have. So I did a lot of work around what we need to do is deconstruct what we know as professionals. If I look around a room, what am I really trying to achieve? How can I do that online? But then it's more than that. It's about the activities, the interactions, the engagements you have with people. And this term digital body language really fits and really resonates. And it comes from marketing. So the guy who came up with it originally is Steve Woods. He came up with it in 2008, 2009. He's written a book on it. But it's from a marketing point of view. And it's very much about all the data that's out there that you can use to analyze where people are on your website, what they're doing, and therefore kind of interpret what they're thinking and what they want to do, just like normal body language is all interpretation. And it's taking those concepts, and I apply it very much about the live and in the moment of what you're typing in chat, if you're using green ticks or checks and crosses, activities that we're doing. And actually you can broaden it out much more now because so much of our work is through email or communities like Slack or Yammer, and also social media. So actually it comes into personal branding and modern communications as well. It's a really huge topic. And I've even just started talking with somebody about it from an emotional quotient, an EQ point of view. So all sorts of different angles you can take on this.
Yeah, it does seem pretty broad. And, you know, just glancing at some of the things that you've put together about it, like even just how, as you mentioned, people communicating in places where there really isn't anybody involved in a sense. I mean, I guess my rational for that statement is that here we are in a live session, at least people can see us. And there's that sense of it, but in those asynchronous moments as well, where people are using, you know, tools or streams or whatever to chat. So having sort of thrown that out then as a, you know, as a definition or a concept, what are some of the things that we can do to, I guess, why is it important? Let's back up to that question.
Yeah. It's important because we are used to being able to be face to face and interpret what people are doing. So right now I see you guys nodding and there's the odd smile, but it's generally a concentrating face. And I'm taking that to mean I'm listening to you. I'm engaged. Tell me more. You know, I'm interpreting it this way. I mean, it could be that you're going, I'm being polite. Let's get her off quickly. You know, it could be that too. So it is down to interpretation. But I'm used to being able to read that, and everything from, you know, your foot bouncing a little bit or your fingers kind of twiddling if you're a little bit nervous, whatever that might be, we're quite used to doing that. It's quite intuitive for us. So when we take that away and we're left with a telephone call or a Skype conversation, an email or a Slack message or thread or a virtual classroom or webinar, well, what do we do? How can we do a version of what we're used to, but in an area where we've lost all those cues that we've relied on for so long?
Mm-hmm. Excellent. Brent, I'll throw the next question to you.
I was just thinking there's a lot of different directions this can go in. When I first started, when you mentioned this as a topic, and I read your blog post, and I was looking through it, and the first thought that came to my mind mentioning like that marketing side of it, right? I thought of digital footprints, right? You know, I've heard that term before, where every place we go on the internet, right, we're leaving footprints and kind of a path. And that's got kind of the negative connotation to it. But I like this spin on it better, where we can use that same data or that similar data within the learning systems and technologies that we're asking people to engage in, whether it's community, portals, Ness, or the courses and all of that. And for us, help figure out, you know, what people are like, what they're thinking, what their motivation is, and where we can go from there. So what are some of those? Let me just finish this thought through real quick. And then there's the other side of it, which is what you were talking about through virtual instructor led training. When you can't see somebody, what are some of the things that we can do to kind of quote unquote see them? So let's just go right into that and tell me a little bit about what are some of those tips and tricks that, because I will point out too that I think what we do here on Crowdcast is a little bit different than what might go on in a training session within GoTo training or WebEx or something like that. So let's maybe clarify that a little bit, and then give us some tips on what people could be doing, because we don't necessarily do all the tips you're probably going to give people, and they're going to be like, these guys really are horrible at it, but they've got this person on telling them how to do it, and they're just not doing all the things right.
Okay, so there's a lot to unpack in there. First point about kind of where it comes from, the digital footprint and stuff. Yeah, I really like the way that this is looking at your digital footprint or the kind of the trail that you leave behind, and interpreting it to make things better. So it's not about your digital footprint and how can we attack you or how can we sell more to you necessarily, but it's about how can we improve our website so that you get to what you want. And it's using all of that really tiny data. And again, as as you say, you can use that in learning to look at, well, when is the LMS most active? When are people watching the videos that we put out? You know, should we put them out Tuesday at 4 p.m. or should we put them out Friday at 11 a.m.? Should we do that weekly or monthly? And that whole area, you know, there's a whole area of data-driven learning when you're looking at more at the assets, like the e-learning and the courses and all that kind of stuff. Whilst I talk and know a little bit about that, that's not my area to focus on. And it's not my area of specialism. But where I really do specialize is more in the communication area. And that's where the digital body language is important, because it's, you're using that in whatever forum is right. So you're absolutely right. This is different from a webinar. This is different from a virtual classroom. Whilst we're using this for learning, it's not that we are delivering a learning lesson. We haven't got this structured. We don't have activities. So what people are doing is they're tuning into a broadcast, much like a TV show, maybe like a radio show style, if you like. And it's very much that people are absorbing what's here. Today's chat window, not overly busy right now. It might become busy later on. People might ask questions. There's the interactivity. And it's about how you guys interact with your audience and with your speaker. But that engagement doesn't have to mean live engagement. If somebody's watching the recording of this, they can be engaged in what's being said and how it's being said, your personality, and also a little bit about the engagement between host and presenter, for instance, or the guests. So that can all be engaging across a recording and a podcast. But then when you get to the live moment, it is about keeping an eye on the chat window, for instance, and bringing in people's comments or the ask a question section at the bottom and responding to those. But where I really focus on from a live point of view is making sure we get over that I can't see them. So at the moment, again, 31 people here, let us know in the chat window, guys. What is it you're thinking? Are you thinking, oh, this is a load of rubbish? Or are you thinking, this is really fascinating and it resonates with me in this way? Let us know, because that's the way that we have the body language. Right now, I don't know the difference. Thank you. I don't know the difference. I can't see you sitting there with your arms crossed and frowning or eagerly leaning forwards and thinking this is amazing, because I've got nothing back from you. So in a webinar or a virtual classroom, what I need to do is ask questions, build in engagement, and that is what is going to bring in that body language. Thank you, Natalie. I now know one person at least is listening eagerly.
Yes, good, great. Good to see everybody jumping in there. Thanks for doing that. I know The Crowdcast platform is so great. They've got a great app. And yeah. So some people just fire up the app on their phone while they're getting ready in the morning. And so they've got kind of one ear in it and one ear in something else, which is great too. We don't mind.
Yeah.
We don't mind that at all. Engagement is great. But, you know, it is that, you know, we know as instructional designers and as good educators that asking questions, right, is always really an important thing to do. But there's other activities and things that can be done in a virtual training session besides just sort of mimicking that asking of the question in the classroom. So where do we take it after we get past the question stuff?
Okay, really good point. And I like your point about knowing your audience. And, you know, everybody's done a version of this is interesting. And thank you so much for that. So if you know your audience and know that often they're going to be listening whilst having breakfast in the morning or whatever, then actually you don't need that engagement from them, because you know that about your audience, either through time or what they've told you or by assumption. So that's really good. In terms of tips, there's all sorts of stuff. If we look at it from a virtual classroom perspective, first of all, because everything you do in a virtual classroom, you can then broaden out to a webinar or a live conversation like we're having. And it is about that interaction. So a virtual classroom, I would say, is using software. It could be Crowdcast, but it could be GoTo, WebEx, Connect, Zoom, one of those pieces of software. And it's perhaps 10 people in your session. You've got them for half an hour, 2 hours, and you're doing some kind of learning lesson. You've got instructional design, you've got learning objectives, and you're going for it. And this, for me, is not about lecturing to people. Otherwise, they could just go and watch a video. This is about the discussion, the activities, and what they're going to do so that they can do something back at work. And therefore, getting over that piece where I don't know people and can't see them, it's all about the interaction and the activity. So this is right from the very beginning. It's sending out the right information so they've got the right hardware. But it's also about making sure you design your sessions really well so that when people come in, you welcome them, get them on the audio so they're not reticent to do it in the main session. That you teach the tools that you need to teach, the emoticons, the chat, how to unmute. That you also design your activities early on to include audio, if that's what you're doing, so that people start doing these things and just know this is going to be interactive. After that, it's then about designing the right activities for learning, but also the interactions for your session. And this is down a little bit to what technology do you use? Is it whiteboard, chat, breakout room, and all the other things that you've got? But also it's building your question properly. So this is where I come back to deconstructing what I used to do. And I think I said this on the session before, if I look around a room face to face, I'm looking for the nods of agreement or the frowns and questions, or the kind of I'm leaning forward and taking notes and maybe I just need to wait for a moment for them to write something down. That's what I can't see. So I can structure my sessions and my questions differently. So whereas I might look around and get that reaction, what I have to do now is say green tick or check mark if you agree with this, if you've had this experience, if you understand, whatever that might be. It's a closed question, but it starts the ball rolling. From there, I might go, brilliant, everybody in the chat room, put a word or two about your experience or what you felt or what happened. Or one person has put a red X and you go, hey, Bob, let's get you unmuted and tell us about that. And then it's how you build those things up and build those things together, because then I'm finding out from people that I know they're engaged because they're doing stuff, but also I'm learning about what they know or they don't know, because I'm not just saying, do you understand 2 + 2 = 4? And everyone goes green check. Yeah. I'm saying, what is 2 + 2? And everybody writes down 4. So I can do those knowledge checks at the same time.
Part of it too is that you're talking about getting people. Sorry, I was watching the comments because you know that's kind of what we have to do. And Jack has a great question in here that we'll work in. But let's stick with the current train of thought for a moment here, and that is that. Sorry, I've got too many things going, and apparently I'm not able to actually stick in one track. Chris, pick a lane. Anyway, I really like the idea that using something simple, but making sure that people are right near the beginning actually engaging with the tool. A little complaint, I use GoToWebinar a lot, and in the GoToWebinar version, it has questions, but it doesn't actually have a chat. And that's I feel that that's missing because people can't really swap, et cetera. It's fine if all you're doing is doing, the formal brain dump, et cetera. But some of those techniques that you're describing are, of course, dependent on the tool offering itself, too.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. So in our tool here, we don't have the green check or cross or the red X, for instance. So, so that's not going to work here, but we do have a chat window we can use. So if I wanted to ask a question of everybody, have you ever attended a virtual classroom? Everybody type either yes or no in the chat, then, or thank you, Jack, she's found a green check. I love you. That's brilliant. Or you can, if you type the colon and type something in, start typing in check, you can find things like the green check marks. That's absolutely awesome. And it is about choosing the right tool for the job. So you're absolutely right about GoToWebinar. So in the chat window, at Mike Lightbulb, who works with me in our company, he's just shared a blog there I wrote about basically hating GoToWebinar with no chat window. So that's an interesting one to go and look at. It's a little bit cheeky the way I've written it as well. But it's then about, well, how can you use what you do have? So if I do something GoToWebinar, I set it up and say, right, we don't have a chat window like normal. So you can't interact with each other, but you can still interact with me. Use the question panel like a chat panel. Type whatever you want, whenever you want. I'll see it. And I can voice that in the session. Just like we've got here, hello from Alan and good morning from Asu. Hello, guys. And then ask for responses and say, everybody type it in the question panel and I can read those out. And Bob says this, and Alice says this. So I can still verbalize that, but it's not the same as a chat window. So you're right, it is software dependent. And this is where knowing your platform, as well as your design and your topic, are all really, really important. And the different software platforms you have will give you different ways to read body language. So WebEx, Cisco WebEx is a really good example. If anybody's seen it from a training center point of view, you get the little red exclamation mark come up if somebody's clicked onto another screen. So that's body language. So just like the traditional body language of me crossing my arms means I'm defensive or whatever it might be. Or no, it means I'm cold or my shoulders hurt. Just like the exclamation mark doesn't mean I'm bored. It could mean I'm translating something into my first language. I'm Googling something because it's interesting. I'm in Word making notes. So it is about interpretation of what's coming through from the software, as well as what you're saying and doing and people are saying and doing in your sessions.
GoToWebinar has a similar sort of alert when people aren't being attentive, and I've gotten to a point where it's sort of like, well, whatever, they haven't hung up yet, you know, they're still here. Just like in a regular meeting, if you've got 20 people in a room, half of them have their phones in their hand, but they're still, you know, involved or still connecting or et cetera. So, yeah,
they could be looking at you and nodding away, and secretly they're thinking, what's on my shopping list? What am I going to do tonight? Yeah. Where should I take somebody on a date? You know, just because they're nodding and haven't got their head in their phone, it doesn't mean they're with you.
Exactly.
Yeah, that's where the questioning comes in, right? That's where you have to make people think a little bit. Yeah.
It seems that many people, when they get onto a webinar or a virtual classroom, forget that and just lecture, including me. That's what I did originally. You should see my first sessions. They were horrific.
Yeah, it's super common that way. And I think from a design perspective, I think that's one of the really, really important parts of having this conversation today. Yes, digital body language is a thing. And I think it sounds very physical, right? It's about the body, and it's about seeing digitally how people are doing things. But really what this says is we need to rethink the design of how we prepare and get ready for something like a virtual classroom in such a different way. Yeah. So instead of maybe in a classroom, you've got your 20 minutes of a total presentation dump you're going to do, and then you've got time for Q&A, right? It's always that, okay, we got time for Q&A at the end. Let me get through all these slides, and then we'll do Q&A at the end. You know, while that's bad in a classroom anyways, it's even worse in the virtual classroom, because you should have some sort of plan where you can hit that first slide and make a few statements about it, interest people, then ask a question, engage them before you move on to the next one, then ask another question and engage them, and get really good at managing that give and take. And I know that's really hard, and that in and of itself is a skill, right? I think it's something that, as we all transition to this online digital training world that we're in and, you know, rapidly expanding, it's just another skill set in our toolbox that we all have to figure out. And kind of along that same note, I've got a story I can save for later, but I was struggled with the whiteboard, a digital whiteboard, for the first time in a meeting. And because I'd never done it before, normally I just point my camera at a real whiteboard and I just whiteboard it out, and the virtual people that are attending the classroom, and they just look that way and they're like, oh, no, we just signed up for Zoom. I think they got the premium of Zoom, and they're like, you can use the whiteboard in Zoom. And all I ended up doing was using the text thing and taking notes as people were talking and throwing things out at me. And I became more like an admin person, just taking notes for the meeting on the whiteboard. And I kept thinking to myself, Joe would be so disappointed in me, because this is not the right use of this tool, I'm certain.
The fact that you used it and you captured everybody's ideas really quickly whilst they were doing it, that's brilliant. Would there be some more inclusive ways of doing it? Maybe. And we can explore that another day. But the fact that you're doing it, you're on your journey, and that's the point. And everybody does things different ways. There are lots of my contemporaries, you know Cindy Huggett, you know Karen Heider, you know Cassie Labori, and they're all absolutely amazing. but we do things different ways. Cassie and I used to deliver together virtual training boot camps. And it was always really interesting because we had the same ethos, the same approach, the same concepts, but we did it differently. And so I'd be saying, oh, I think you should do the activity this way. She's like, no, I think we should do it this way. And it's kind of her thing. So we did it her way. But every now and then one of mine snuck in, and it was really good for me to look at doing things a different way and for Cassie, because there's not just one way to do this, but there is a way of approaching it that is different from face to face, so that it's not a struggle, so that what we're doing is we're building in the interactions, engagements and activities so that we've got a chance to read that body language from other people. Normally we would just look. So we have to create the interactions online to enable us to look, basically.
Let's bring Jack's question in here before I forget it, because, you know, apparently my brain isn't keeping stuff today. So Jack typed in as a question, as a frequent viewer of the replays of IDIODC, I miss the opportunity to give my own input or questions after the presentation. How do you look for feedback from those folks to help them and capture their digital body language? So, really? You know, working from things of like recordings of sessions, et cetera, yeah. Too.
So it's a really good question. And it's something that you can have in webinars, especially within organizations or sort of marketing webinars or learning webinars. But also this can be a challenge for kind of more virtual classrooms where not everybody's on the session. And there's a whole debate about whether you should record them and stuff. And that's for another day. I think what's really important, there are a couple of things you can do here. When you're designing your session, if you know there are going to be people in this situation, if we're talking about a learning session rather than something like IDIODC, is you can build in those questions and actually say things and say, and if you're watching the recording, whilst the guys are writing on the whiteboard, make notes yourself. What do you think? Or it could be you've got a workbook or some description, page 6, make your notes there. But also this is about digital body language, especially, but any of these learning topics are about much more than just the individual session. It's about the whole course, if you want to call it that, but also it's about the whole learning opportunity and your workflow. So it could be that you've got a Slack group or a forum. I've got a free community, for instance. And it's a case then of going, well, you know what, we've got resources. So we're launching very, very soon. We're piloting tomorrow, a continuous professional development series. And what we're going to do is have a separate community for that. We'll share a resource or a facilitator guide or a questions template, for example. And we'll be able to say to someone like Jackie, it's on the recording, you've got the resource there, go and ask your questions there. So you go to the resource and then you put in there, I didn't quite understand when Joe said such and such, or Bob asked this great question, can we expand on it here? So your forum or your question area is a really great way to do that. And that is capturing their digital body language, as Jack says. And that's a whole other topic about doing that on forums, and HT2 and Ben Betts' company doing amazing work in things like sentient analysis of the language. And that's a whole other area that's not quite my area, but that's something I'd love to know more about.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I was just thinking, I'm always surprised by the number of people who join us every week for this. It's kind of mind-boggling, but then also bumping into other people who go, oh yeah, I listen to the podcast, et cetera. And maybe Brent, we have to look at something, you know, like a follow-up community or a place to support, I guess, the IDIODC stuff too. That's just for us to talk about and figure out what we can do. Oh, well, Jack's given us the all caps yes.
Yeah. That's the one person that'll attend, so it's good.
It could be. I mean, it would be amazing to do that on Slack or, I hate to say, a LinkedIn group, but something like that. But also it could equally be on Twitter. That's a really easy place to start. You've got hashtag IDIODC. You know, that's a great place to start that conversation. Lita says, I'm already on Slack all the time. I don't know if that's a good or a bad thing, Lita.
By the way, Joe, you are totally empowered to just say hashtag IDIODC, because that's how we all promote
wow,
ourselves.
It's not my place to say that.
No, we embrace it.
Just roll with it. It's all good.
Okay.
Yeah, I was gonna say I have significant empathy for Jack and what she's talking about, because when I go back and watch the recordings, not the podcast, which is the audio, but when I go in and watch the Crowdcast recordings, and I'm listening in intently. I'm so used to the chat being live and going that I've found myself going to the chat box and wanting to add my comment, and then all of a sudden realizing, what am I doing? I'm watching the dang recording. This isn't live. And so it's like, once you get used to the live, the recording is kind of odd to sit through. But so I get it, Jack. I totally, totally get it. There's definitely a bit of cognitive dissonance there.
But that's where something like Twitter can come into its own realm, especially with something like this. And what I've done, I don't know if it's good, bad or otherwise, but what I've done is, as I've been listening to an episode, I've put in, I'm listening to hash idiotic with at whoever and at whoever. And they've made a great point about such and such. And then 3 minutes later, like, oh, I love that bit. I'm listening to hash idiotic and yada yada and so on, and sharing it that way. Maybe nobody picks it up. Maybe it's not conversation. Or maybe, you know, the person who was the speaker goes, oh, I'm really glad you liked that point. Or, you know, Brent comes on and says, no, you've got it out of context. Or Chris says, that's absolutely right. And we've got more stuff here, a chat with somebody else that you can go and listen to. So that's a different way of doing it. And this is what's really nice about technology, social media, and all of the different options we have, from something like this to in-house virtual classrooms, is you can do different ways of following that up. If you allow for it, you know, that could just be emailing me or DMing me and saying, that was terrible, but I'd like to pick your brains. Or that was really interesting. Can you tell me more about this? Or I didn't really understand such and such. Can you tell me a bit more? Or can I have a link to your blog again?
And for me, that's what I think the goal is for a show like this, right? Like, we're giving information, we're giving tips and tricks and stuff like that. But really, it's a way to introduce people to the community and to bring our collection of peers and colleagues together, to meet new people that maybe they've never met before, and to start to feel comfortable so they can reach out and get more in depth and to move on. Because, you know, Lord knows it's too early in the morning and we're just drinking coffee, trying to barely talk through stuff. So I don't know if we're instructing much.
And Mike points out, making hashtag idiotic a good thing for a change. So
yes. It's always been a good thing, right? Yeah.
for us, I think it's always been a presumption or a statement of that we're you know, tabula rasa on this in many topics, and we bring our naivete to it and as participate in the learning journey with you.
Exactly. I always find myself typing, please welcome the idiotic guest, and then I put somebody's name and I'm thinking to myself, that I'm gonna have to figure out how to rephrase that, or our idiotic guest this week is so and so, and I'm like, that's not really coming across so well. That's bad digital body language.
No, I think that describes me really well. I'm okay with that.
Well, we're at the bottom of the hour, and we do like to keep these a little bit shorter than other live streams and whatnot. But let's drop a few more tips that maybe we might have missed, Joe. I know you've got probably a handful of value and valuable, you know, tips. Just some quick ones that you might have that you normally share.
So if you're doing any kind of webinar or virtual classroom and you've got to get through a certain amount of content, look at what really needs to be in the session to be learned and discussed and take away. What can be some kind of video, PDF, website, email link follow-up for later that they don't really need right there and then? Because it's all about the engagement. Get them involved early on. Use different parts of the platform that you've got available to you. Make sure you're building a rapport and a relationship with people and you're reacting to them. So therefore you might use a poll, but then you go down a slightly different conversation than you would have done depending on the results. But you link that in with tell me more in the chat window. You link that in with Bob, let's get you unmuted so that we can hear more about it. Because this is about nuance. This is about using different tools so that you can get to know people a lot more. Encourage use of the chat window, not just for answering questions, but for people talking to each other, because you will get engagement from that. You will get to know people from their banter, from their humor, from their questions, from the use of their language and what words that they're using. So all of those things, the more you can get, the more you're going to hear it, the more you're going to have that kind of perception of what's going on with your groups. You know, if somebody's always the first one to click the green check mark or the last one to click the green check mark, you can start thinking about, how do I interpret that? Do I need to check in with them and just find out, you know, are you making notes? Are you translating something? Am I boring you? Are you having to multitask or not? But all of that is about interpreting that body language. If you don't put in the engagement and the activities and build those up in a special way for virtual classrooms and webinars, then you won't be able to read that from people. And Eric, really, really great statement there. Engage with the audience, not with the interface. I wish I'd said that, Eric. That is absolutely brilliant.
Yeah, we've got to remember that it's not just the camera on the monitor. It's actually the people beyond that we're really trying to work with.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. Awesome. I always talk to, if I'm on camera, I try and look at the camera. But when I'm talking, I tend to talk to the chat window because they're the people. And here I can see pictures, which is awesome. But even then, I can see names. So I can see Mike, Lita, Jack, Mike, and other people as well, Asu and Eric. So actually, they're the people. They're the people I'm talking to. So that's where my eye naturally goes to. And if you've got that engagement, you've got your digital body language. And that really helps with your kind of virtual perception. And I think that's really important. And it's something we're going to explore a little bit more on. We've got podcasts. We explore loads of stuff on that. It's me and my Mike chatting with each other. We've got some guests on there. We've had a fabulous guest, Mike Taylor, who is in the chat window today. Also, we've got that new continuous professional development series we are launching very, very soon, piloting tomorrow. Wish me luck. We will see how that goes. And maybe I'll come back and tell you more another day about that.
That I was just going to say,
I know Mike's on there. So please drop some links in. Let people know how they can get in touch with you, how they connect with you. That session, unfortunately, is 4 a.m. my time. I was really super excited to be a part of your pilot. And then I saw the time and I thought, oh, dang it. This work over the seas sort of thing is just killing me. But any other week, 4 a.m., I'd totally set my alarm for it. But
you're too kind, Brent, too kind.
But I am rooting for you.
Thank you. Good.
Excellent. That's probably a good place for us to bring in the music and dance everybody out. Joe, thanks so much for joining us. As always, a tremendously fabulous conversation. Some really cool things that I think lots of people can take away from and have as leaping off points. And hey, if you're in here today and you're thinking about this later, throw a question in the Twitter stream with the hashtag idiotic, and we'll see what comes of that. And maybe there's some other things we can point you to.
Absolutely. Use that idiotic hashtag a lot. We're going to start talking a lot more about that and start engaging a lot more. So if you are watching, recording and doing that, Twitter's a great place for us to have some really fun conversations and to get other people involved in the conversation. I'm sure there's people out there that still don't even know that we do enjoy drinking coffee in the morning with each other and hanging out, talking shop. So
we do.
And listening to great tiki music.
That's the number one thing on our charts, that's for sure.
Joe, thank you so much.
Thank you, guys. Thank you, everyone. Bye.
Bye-bye, everybody. We'll see you next time.